Good evening. Welcome to the Northampton City Council meeting of August 13th. I'm City Council President Bill Dwight, and I'll be presiding. Let me turn off my phone. Sorry. Thank you all for coming. What we normally do, our traditional procedure is to start with public session, but actually, I'm going to ask everyone's indulgence for a moment, and I think it's appropriate. We recently lost someone close to us who worked here for the city of Northampton. Mike Sims died on Sunday, and I would ask just for a moment of silence to reflect on his good work and his family. Thank you. So what we do now is time for public comment, and the public is invited to speak on any topic of their choosing. And the constraints are, please stay under 3 minutes, and keep you can speak on any subject, but you have to understand the council is not allowed to respond. This is your time to speak, not our time, but we'll be talking into the late hours tonight anyway. The other thing that I ask is that you just respect the decorum of the chamber and of the council. So first up, well, I only have Jasper Lapienski signed up. Jasper.
I did have some, so I'm Jasper Lapienski. I live at 43 West Street. You forgot to say that. So,
thank you. Good job.
Yep. I do have some prepared remarks. I'll get to them maybe. But seeing as how I almost got hit by a car twice in the same spot in the last 8 hours or so, I figured it's worth bringing up. There's a right turn lane from Elm Street onto South Street that deserves its own arrow. There are three poles, one for a traffic light, one for a sign, and one for a street light or something else. And so the cars can't see the humans as they come around the corner at 30 miles an hour on the green light. It's, as far as I know, the only traffic light in Hampshire County that does not have its own pedestrian phase. So people who are not used to it don't think, oh, there's a white human, I can go, somebody's going to crash into me. I think that, and it still doesn't work. And I'm not convinced that it's safe. I know that we've had problems with other areas within a block or so of that, maybe not there yet. I would say that that is likely going to be the next one, and we should probably take care of it in advance. I don't think it would be very expensive, and I don't think it would cause a lot of traffic to do so. Let's see if I can pare down what I actually meant to talk about. To the second half. I want to take the opportunity of this forum to express my heartfelt appreciation for every parking cop in this city. I don't own a car myself, but I do use cars and have received parking tickets in town on 3 occasions. I think all the parking cops in town do a great job. Not once in 6 years living here have I ever heard you be accused of discriminating against black vehicles, and not once have any of you in the heat of the moment mistakenly stuck a ticket on a car that was just waiting for a light to turn green. I jest, but you take a lot of flack for the same pay as other city workers, and you brave the streets in all weather for the sake of doing your job. Thank you for your service to the taxpayers of Northampton. The context was missed, but it had to do with my talking about cops versus firefighters and how we appreciate them in the last meeting. Thanks.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I neglected to sign up.
That's fine. If you haven't signed up, just come up, state your name and address, and
sure,
have your piece.
My name is Phil Wilson. I live at 12 Pilgrim Drive in Northampton. I'm a CSO employee. And I'm here to advocate for the possibility of a council resolution in support of the union and the grievances that CSO employees have had against management, and that we are working without a contract, and that negotiations have been completely stalled by management's unwillingness to come to the table. I'm going to read a very short statement and maybe add a few comments. Management at CSO has told the union that there will be no further negotiating, and that the offer voted down by 87% of voting union SEIU 509 CSO members is the final offer that management will make. Management has offered the union a one penny raise for mileage over a 3-year time period, 1/3 of a cent per year. Mileage reimbursement currently works out to be about $12 per hour for travel time. Management has also offered fee-for-service clinicians a 1% raise over the same 3-year period, and salaried clinicians have been offered a so-called 3% yearly raise, provided they increase productivity by 2.3%. The math works out to 0.7% raise per year. I should add that the average full-time master's-level licensed clinicians make about $36,000 a year, provided they take no vacation or use no sick time. Bachelor's level workers make about $25,000 at CSO, about the median income for U.S. Bureau of Labor Statistics for high school dropouts. We do not buy into the mendacious management argument that our low salaries result primarily from state reimbursement rates. CSO CEO Karen Jeffers boasted last week in a guest column that CSO has grown from a company of 93 employees to one of 580 workers in just 9 years. The expansion included millions of dollars of real estate acquisition, huge pay raises for Ms. Jeffers, who makes about $250,000 a year, and the hiring of high-priced law firm, which Jobs for Justice is called the number one union-busting law firm in Massachusetts, Scholar Abbott and Presser, to handle union negotiations. I should mention that Jeffers has never shown up at bargaining talks, and that Scholar, Abbott, and Presser lawyer Tim Murphy is the only CSO representative in bargaining interactions. The real elephant in the room is the dehumanizing corporatization of community mental health, an endeavor that has a long-standing tradition in progressive philosophy and egalitarian idealism. I don't know if my 3 minutes are...
You got 2 seconds. Well done. Does anyone else wish to speak? Come on up, just state your name and address and have at it.
I'm Andrew Berger. I actually live in Williamsburg. I just moved.
So it's okay.
Okay.
Everyone's allowed to speak, so
I live at 5B South Street in Williamsburg. I lived in Northampton until July for 7 years.
You get credit for that.
Okay, good. I work at CSO as well. I'm an outpatient clinician like Phil. I work at the office on Atwood Street in Northampton. We provide a really vital public service for Northampton and for Hampshire County and for a lot of Western and Central Massachusetts. We just want to be able to make this sustainable and stay in the field. There's been a lot of turnover at our company. We've tried to negotiate for the past 9 months with CSO management. As Phil mentioned, we haven't really had a face-to-face with our CEO. She hasn't come to negotiations. There are a couple HR people there, but they don't speak. So really, all of the communication's been funneled through this corporate lawyer. We're trying to get them to see that we actually have, you know, really valid needs. The productivity demands have gone up, and so we are working harder, and our pay is not keeping up with inflation. We're simply asking for CSO to acknowledge that and to see what they can do out of the piece of the pie that they can allocate for employees, see what they can do and talk to us respectfully. We haven't had that happen, which is why we went to the point of striking. We are asking communities where we work to support us now because we really feel like there are unfair labor practices. When we went on strike, they threatened to replace people with temporary workers. They threatened to take away people's health insurance. They took away people's health insurance for a three-day strike, which is really unprecedented. We talked to Blue Cross Blue Shield, and they were shocked that for a three-day strike, that this company was so hard-hitting. So we're really surprised, and we're asking the community to come out and say, hey, we support good jobs in a very important field, and we support fair pay. We support open communication with your workers. We don't like a company that's a nonprofit that gets most of its funding from public taxpayer sources, acting like a huge corporation and not respecting workers. And we think Northampton's that kind of place that stands for this. So thank you.
I'm Shelley Berkowitz, and I've lived in Northampton for 20 years. I'm a family doctor in this community, and I'd like to say something on the same topic, but from a different perspective. I have two different perspectives that I want to share about this issue, and I'm not somebody who normally comes out and speaks publicly about any issue, pretty much. The first perspective I see this from is as a primary care physician in this community. My patients who have mental illnesses are not able to access health care, primary health care services in my office to get either their chronic illnesses treated or get any preventive care if they have mental illnesses that are destabilized by the lack of continuity in their mental health care. And that happens when companies, quote unquote, like CSO, has such a huge turnover rate among clinicians because they're not paid a living wage. When these folks can't access primary care, they end up in the emergency room. And what does that mean? It means they take ambulances. The costs are tremendous to our country and our local economy, and they don't get the care that they need. There was a letter that was in the Gazette that I wrote, and that was endorsed by a number of primary care physicians in our community endorsing this for this reason. And that's the first perspective I see this from. The other perspective is as the wife of Phil, who I can say that I've seen for the past 9 years him working there. I will raise my right hand and say, though I'm left-handed, that he has not had a single compensated day of vacation or sick time in 9 years. If he takes a day off, which is extremely rare, he basically has to go back and work an extra day to make up those hours that he's lost because our health insurance, mine, his, our family's, is prorated based on the productivity that has been explained. If he goes down to 7/8 time, then an eighth of it we have to pay. If he goes down to 6/8, 2/8, so forth. There's no zero retirement contribution, no sick time. He's only compensated, not him, all of them, for billable hours, and that's the difference. There was an article in today's Gazette that I'd be happy to have you, if you haven't seen the Gazette today, a full-page column, one written by Phil and then back-to-back one by Karen Jeffers, showing the opposite sides of this, and I urge you to read it if you haven't. I believe I have a copy here that you'd be welcome to see. And furthermore, CSO clinicians, they do things that are totally uncompensated, surely out of the goodness of their heart many times. Some of the things they're required to do, billing, paperwork, etc., but they do things that are uncompensated. I'm going to give you one example and end, okay? There was a fire in Greenfield last week, and two of Phil's clients, a family, I don't know their names due to confidentiality, but I do know that their house burned down. There were seven families who lost their homes. They are now homeless and in shelters. And because they had three cats with no place to go and the community rallied, they got cat carrying cases. These kitties are now in my basement because they have no place to go. And this is the kind of thing that CSO workers do for their clients. This is not billable. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Anyone else wish to speak at this time? Going once, going twice.
Okay, thank you. Thank you all. I'll ask the clerk to call the roll, please.
Councilor Adams.
Here.
Councilor Klein.
Present.
Councilor Dwight.
Here.
Councilor Klein.
Here.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Here.
Councilor Sherriff.
Here.
Councilor Spector.
Here.
We have three public hearings scheduled, one right after the next. The first public hearing is regarding Mayor Narkowitz's proposed administrative order change, and I'll ask for a motion to open the public hearing.
So motion. Second.
Okay, any discussion? All those in favor of opening the public hearing, please say aye.
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 Aye. First, we'll hear from the proponents, and I would suspect that would be the mayor.
Good evening, honorable members of the City Council. You have a memo that I submitted to you back in July as part of this administrative order. I tried to outline in the memo the reasons why we believe that combining these two city offices, the office of the treasurer and the office of the collector, would result in a more efficient, streamlined organizational structure for our financial team. In that original letter, I cited some statistics from the Department of Revenue that I'd read in another study of a neighboring city. In the intervening time, I did reach out to the Department of Revenue and submitted my proposal to them. And I know that I believe I circulated to you on Monday. We received a letter from the Department of Revenue, essentially going through the proposal and offering their endorsement of the proposal, as well as providing us with a breakdown of other communities like-sized, city budget. And pointing out that 75% of those communities had moved toward this combined treasure collector model. So I'm happy to answer any questions that folks have, and I hope you will give it consideration.
Any questions from the council? Comments? Councilor Adams?
It's more efficient, saves money, it's good.
Are there any opponents who wish to speak on this, or people with questions or thoughts? All right. Councilor Sherriff.
Just have a quick question. Is there any additional staff that is needed?
Actually, we are doing some other reorganization as part of the overall operation, and so it'll actually result in a reduction in one full-time employee, one full-time staffer. So when we finish combining the two, the treasurer's office, which is a two-person office, and then the current collector's office, we're projecting that it'll result in one less staff person. And obviously, so that'll be the result. Mm-hmm.
Councilor LaBarge.
Reducing personnel costs, correct? Also, we're looking at health insurance, which is a tremendous amount of money. I have been involved before when we took the treasurer's office, and it was an elected official position, and then it became non-elected official. I think this is in the right direction. I think it makes sense. And I think with a treasurer and then going into combining both is efficient. And to me, with the Department of Revenue, I read it and they agree to it, and it's cost efficient, and I think it's the right direction.
Okay.
Your Honor, if you could just hit some bullet points about the things that you think are going to be an improvement. I mean, especially given the fact that we're going to lay off an individual here.
We are.
But if you could hit the bullet points about the improvements in productivity and the reductions of costs and ultimately the experience of the citizens.
Certainly, and I may also ask the finance director, who actually directly oversees the department as well. I'll give you one particular example. Under our current structure, the collector's office maintains a bank account, and the treasurer's office maintains a bank account, and hold monies. The collector more on a short-term basis when monies come in, and then has to move those over to the treasurer, who then deposits them. So we'll be consolidating all of those activities into one one banking transaction, as opposed to having to hold those funds. And that's actually something that the Department of Revenue has recommended when they've looked at our systems in the past. A lot of the tax title and property related issues, the two offices sort of work hand in hand, because most of the money that gets collected, most of the revenue that gets collected comes into the collector's office, and then the treasurer has responsibility for actually accounting for it and making the deposits and then paying out to folks. So those are two examples. I can ask the finance director to describe more if you'd like.
I'm concerned about what would be the enhancements for what would be the public's experience of the enhancements, whether it be a more efficient management of the way
we believe one of the pieces of it is an efficiency with which we can turn over the receipts and get them deposited when we receive funds. So when a citizen comes in to pay a bill or to pay a water bill or to pay a parking ticket or pay whatever, it's going to increase efficiency in terms of the speed by which we can process those. So, in terms of the customer experience, we're always striving for a better customer experience when people come in. Citizens don't generally go to the treasurer's office. That's not really a place that citizens go. They tend to give their money to the collector, who then has to turn it over to the treasurer. And that's why many cities have combined these two positions into one. So it's more of an internal efficiency than it is an external. But I would defer to the finance director who has also studied this and talked with the DOR about it. So I'd like to have her thoughts on it as well.
Bard, you have a question while Susan's coming up. You have a question.
Mayor.
Yeah.
Looking at which was extremely helpful was the treasurer and collector departments throughout the communities. And it's impressive that the percentage of your treasurer collector departments among per communities is 75%. That's high. Percentage of combined treasurer collector departments statewide is 63.5%. So you can see, you're coming from Agawam, Amherst, East Stanton, Franklin, Gloucester, Melrose, Milford, and it works its way down. West Springfield, this is nothing new. They are doing these changes, and to me, it makes sense when you're combining treasurer and collector's office. My question is, either the mayor or Susan, now we're having a treasurer going possibly into the collector's office. Does she get a pay raise for that because she's doing another job? I would like an explanation on that, please.
Well, if and when you create the position, we will look at regrading the position because it will mean an increased responsibility, including supervisory. So that will happen. But when you look at the combined position, it will still be a savings over paying two higher level, department head level folks. And so there will be a savings there as well.
Right. Health insurance alone is huge. Thank you.
Susan, do you have anything to add?
Just that it's interesting because I've just spent the last 3 days at the Mass Association of Treasurer and Collectors Conference, which has been over at UMass. And the fact that these two positions are so integral in that they have so much overlap. They hold their conference together. Their classes are very similar. There's a collector's track and there's a treasurer's track, and I spent the first 3 years doing all the treasurer classes, and now I'm doing the collector classes. But it's very interesting because at the start of just about every workshop, they say, so who's a treasurer, who's a collector, who's both? And the majority of the hands in the room go up because they're the treasurer collector. So it's just a very natural combining. One of the main things that I think customers may experience is if they are in tax title, right now they deal with the collector for a certain amount of time for about a year, and then the accounts go into tax title, they go over to the treasurer, then they're dealing with a totally different person. So what's going to be nice about this, and we don't have a huge amount of people in tax title, but it is a stressful period for people, so they're going to end up working with the same person through the whole process. So that is going to be one of the main things that will streamline it. And as the mayor said, just the ability to get money into the accounts faster is good for the city's cash flow. It's good for interest. And as far as the customers, again, they're going to see changes, but I think they're all going to be, you know, they're going to be positive. They're going to be coming into the office. It's going to be a different office organization if you approve this. And we also think that combining these will be able to deal with the inevitable ebbs and flows of the workload, because we'll have one more staff person over here. We'll be able to distribute the workload a little bit differently. And that way, when one office is having kind of a peak workload, we're going to have an extra hand.
Any other questions before we close the hearing? We did have a motion and a second let's try again. Is there a motion to close the hearing?
Make a motion to close the hearing.
Second. All those in favor of closing the public hearing, please say aye.
Aye.
Okay, and this will come up now. Excuse me, there will be a vote relative to this coming up in the there's a vote now for to accept or not, but there's also another vote coming up that's relevant you'll see coming down later in the agenda. I'll accept a motion for approval.
Make a motion for approval.
Second.
Discussion on the motion.
Councilor O'Donnell. Clarification, we're just accepting the proposal.
That's correct.
We're receiving it, yeah.
There's a request for two readings. It'll be a two reading vote.
There's no.
It requires two votes.
But
well, I do have a question. I know the last time we did this, we did two readings.
Right.
I don't actually think you have to do two readings, but if the council wants to do two readings, I'm fine with you doing a second reading.
Actually, I'd be more comfortable doing one reading tonight and then another.
That's totally fine. Yeah, that's totally fine. I just, as a procedural matter, looking at your rules and looking at the charter, this isn't a council order.
Right.
In fact, the charter specifically says the council can't promulgate this kind of an order.
Right.
Only I can present this order, and you can only vote up or down. So it's more like an appointment than it is a council order. But I'm happy if you do it on a second reading at another meeting. It's fine.
So there's been a motion made for first reading in any event, second. Any further discussion or clarification? Roll call, please.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shira?
Yes.
Councilor Spector?
Yes.
Councilor Adams?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Okay. Passes in first reading. Next one will be at our meeting in September. We have another hearing for poll petitions, a National Grid. We're going to get you up, please, I guess. So I'll accept a motion to open hearing.
Move to open hearing.
Second.
Second. Okay. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? We'll start with proponents. Jason, you're up.
Good evening, Councilor Dwight, members of the council. I am Lisa Jasinski with National Grid, looking once again for permission to place a pole on city property. It's on Spring Street, and it's going to be a pole that's going to bring the service to the new concession stands for the athletic fields that have been put in down there. It's to bring power across the street, and then they'll go underground out to the I think I'll call them concession stands for now, but the buildings that'll be going up down at the new athletic fields in the corner of Meadow and Spring.
Any questions about this? There was a memo from Ned Huntley that concerning sight lines, but it's for vegetation management or something along the sight lines to make sure that I wasn't clear on that memo.
I'll speak with Ned about it. I did speak with, I wished I wrote the gentleman's name down because I deal with Dave Valletta all the time, and it wasn't Dave on this job. But
you deal with Felix Harvey.
I think so.
Yeah.
Yeah. And he was concerned because there wasn't a stake in the ground when he first went out there, and I went back out and put the stake back in, and all that. He was okay with. I hadn't heard back from him that, you know, that I told him that it was in, left him the message, and let him know that it was in there. And
he merely says, while there may be a minimal site distance restriction caused by the pole, I believe the vegetation along Spring Street to the west of the driveway must be monitored and trimmed to alleviate a site distance issue that will arise if this vegetation continues to grow, which, well, I gather is not your issue. So, okay. All right. Any other questions for Lisa? Are there any opponents or any questions? I'll accept a motion to close the public hearing.
Close the public hearing.
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Now I'll accept a motion to approve.
Move to approve.
Second.
Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor
LaBarge? Yes. Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor
Chair? Yes.
Councilor Adams?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes. Lisa, you got your poll.
All set. Thank you.
All right, thank you. I know you got another appointment, so. We have another poll.
I don't have the.
You don't have the stuff on it?
I do not.
That's the one on North Main.
On North Main?
Oh, I, you know what, that it's not going to be a petition for the city. It ended up being an easement when I spoke with the city. I thought that we spoke about that. It's on private property, and we obtained an easement for it. I did speak with the DPW about that one.
Oh, damn, I really did want another public hearing, so. All right, well, suit yourself.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So we do have another public hearing, and this is, it's a public hearing regarding the adoption of the Northampton multi-hazard mitigation plan. I'll accept the motion to put it on the floor.
The motion to put it on the floor.
Second.
All those in favor, open the public hearing. Please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Now, Your Honor.
I know that no member of the planning staff could be here tonight, partially because Mr. Fiden's out of town and partially
because you're on
the same night of the planning board. But I think the memo outlines very clearly that council voted on this back in April, but for purposes of a grant, they didn't like the language that was used in that original, and so they want clearer approval language. And we're trying to get a grant application submitted in time. That's the request for two readings, to just basically amend your previous vote from an endorsement to actual adoption of the plan.
You'll recall this discussion at the last meeting, I think we did talk about this. The planning department came and represented that, in fact, is that we did approve this. The language simply said that we were going to adopt it. The state didn't like that. They wanted us not to adopt it, but to approve it. They want adoption. So are there any questions about relative to the adoption? I will ask, if knowing what the answer is going to be, are there any opponents? Yep, not surprised. So the okay. I'll accept the motion to close the public hearing.
Close the public hearing.
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed. Okay. Now, to adopt the Northampton multi-hazard mitigation plan, I'll accept a motion.
Move we adopt the plan.
Second.
Make a motion to adopt the plan.
It's a motion's been made and second. Any further discussion? Yep. wait to read it. Moving at breakneck speed. Okay. Roll call, please.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Taylor.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Allen.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor White.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Okay. That passes in first reading. And we'll revisit that for a second. No, we don't. No, actually, it's adopted. Thank you.
No, they do want two
readings. They want two readings tonight?
Yes.
Yep.
Move second reading.
Second.
I'll accept a motion to suspend rules first.
Oh,
Motion to suspend the rules. Second.
Okay, and discussion on suspension rules to allow for a second reading tonight. All those in favor of suspending rules, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Okay, now I'll accept a motion to put it on.
Move second reading.
Second.
Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shearer.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Okay. That's passed in two readings. Next up, let's see, we have any communications from the mayor? Oh, yes, a proclamation, Your Honor.
I have one proclamation this evening, and actually I want to thank Councilor LaBarge. This is something that she'd called to our attention last year. Unfortunately, it was too late to do it last year, so we're trying to recognize this year. It's actually for a national day that's happening next week, August 26th, and it's National Dog Day. You'll note that my proclamation has a
paw print.
So. Whereas National Dog Day was founded in 2004 to honor dogs of all breeds, pure and mixed, for their service and loyalty, while reminding us of the many dogs needing to be rescued each year. And whereas the motto of the National Dog Day Foundation is, quote, saving 10,000 dogs one day at a time, unquote, with the goal of finding homes for all dogs in need of a loving family. And whereas dogs help us in many ways through their companionship and service, selflessly protecting us in roles of law enforcement, companionship for the disabled, and assistance in times of tragedy. And whereas we can honor all dogs for providing unconditional love, protection, and aid to those in need by becoming educated and advocating for a community where all dogs can live a happy and safe life free from abuse. And therefore I, Mayor David J. Narkowitz, do hereby recognize and celebrate August 26, 2015 as National Dog Day, asking the citizens of Northampton to show their deep appreciation for the connection and companionship that we have with dogs. In witness whereof, I have set my hand and imprinted the seal of the City of Northampton. And that's my only communication this evening.
If there were a dog with opposable thumbs, I'm sure they'd come up and accept this in gratitude. So. Next up, we have a resolution. This is in support of mental health workers, and this is upon the recommendation of Councilors Jesse Adams and Maureen Carney. It's a resolution in support of mental health workers. And whereas the City of Northampton recognizes that adequate mental health care is essential to a good quality of life, and whereas the role of mental health workers is vitally important and critical to the health and safety of our community. And whereas mental health workers help those in need of mental health services, which include some of our community's most at risk and vulnerable people, in an effort to provide them with stability, growth, and a positive quality of life. And whereas despite serving some of the community's most at risk and vulnerable populations, mental health workers are frequently undervalued and underpaid. And whereas the adequate pay for mental health workers will demonstrate a true commitment to the mental health services and those who provide them. And whereas the City of Northampton recognizes that adequate funding of human services is needed to pay mental health workers for the critical and vital work they do. Now therefore, be it resolved that the City of Northampton stands with the workers of Clinical Support Options, DBA CSO, in support of them, and urges the CSO administrators to reach a swift and fair resolution with adequate pay and benefits for mental health workers and advocates who for adequate funding of human services to provide CSO administrators with the necessary means of providing adequate pay and benefits. I'll accept a motion and put that on the floor.
So moved. Second.
Councilor Adams, would you like to speak to this?
Sure. The first thing I'd like to do to move to add Councilor Marianne LaBarge as a sponsor.
As your wish, so we'll include that.
Okay. Well, this resolution is in support of the mental health field generally, but it's in recognition of the struggle that the workers in the union at CSO are going through. I feel that recognition, that adequate pay is recognition of the work that mental health workers do, and that adequate pay is one way of acknowledging the work that they do and is essential. This is constituent driven. This came to us
by constituent request. It involves a very live issue. There are contract negotiations, installed contract negotiations, and it's an important community issue. I'm familiar with it. My fiance is actually a frontline direct care mental health worker for ServiceNet, so that makes me familiar with it in a different way. The resolution calls for increased funding for human services, and that includes behavioral health services. It does not attempt to demonize management or undermine how difficult collective bargaining can be, though it does concern me that the CEO doesn't even take part in the process. The CEO of CSO doesn't take part in the process. I find that concerning. But it recognizes what I think is the larger issue of adequate funding of human services and behavioral health services to give management the proper means to provide adequate pay and benefits to mental health workers. So this is in support of the workers and the union, but it's a positive message for positive change for human services.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes. I support this 100%. I was in the field for 35 years. And when I saw this resolution, I had talked to Councilor at Large, Jesse Adams, of supporting this. Dealing with many, many residents all over the community all my life, people really don't understand how valuable it is and how special a person is to have to take care of somebody with special needs. Their quality of life depends on the individual who is actually trained to take care of that patient or resident. I think all the years that I've dealt with it, everybody was underpaid. And I don't know what it's going to actually take for them to actually realize the reasons why they're short of staff all the time. Direct care staff, social workers, everybody say, we cannot live this way. The pay is so low. But I think they need to get in there and actually work it to see what it's all about to take care of somebody who needs that special needs, definitely needs that touch, needs to have that experience, and be able to give that person a new life, a new quality of life, educate them, which a lot of them did not have. It's bringing them back into a community from going in from normalization out into communitization. There's no question about it. And it takes valuable, valuable staff to make that happen. So I feel that everybody who works with people who have different types of behaviors or disabilities should have an equal pay to work for organizations.
I guess the important thing for me in this resolution is to note that we're advocating for a swift and fair resolution, and in order to do that, there really does need to be a commitment to negotiation. And right now, there's been a failure of negotiation, and both parties are not at the table. So Northampton is faced with many mental health challenges, including opioid and addiction problems. And the citizens of Northampton do deserve to know that their state funds and taxes are being used and prioritized in order to really help provide service delivery in this regard. So I'm just hoping that both parties will be able to come back to the table and continue negotiation, because stalled negotiation. We know that in the public sector we have, binding arbitration and other means mm-hmm. to be able to resolve problems like this. But right now, the federal mediation failed, and as far as I know, there's been just a refusal to come back to the table.
So if anything can be stressed, it would be that a swift and fair resolution really requires people sitting at the table and negotiating, and I'm just hoping that that can happen. As Councillor Adams noted, it would also be helpful to have the actual decision makers at the table rather than just proxies. So if this resolution does anything to try to encourage that further, that's why I was a sponsor and urge my colleagues to support it.
I would speak to the larger point. The fact is that the Northampton has time and again supported a living wage for members of the community and people who work within the city. And we have trouble walking the talk at times. The fact is that Northampton actually relies on an increasing number of medical services. You'll see that Atwood Drive is a perfect example, expansion of that up in Florence. A number of medical services, mental health services that are provided in the community. It has become the equivalent of the mines for Virginia in some sense. Many people who live and work within this community need the wages from those jobs, providing services for other people in the community to sustain them within the community. You can't have one without the other. They actually, in fact, are mutually exclusive. And we, the fact that this resolution calls for and it's directed to one particular instance, this one that comes to the one with CSO right now, but in the larger frame, this is something that while we want to encourage business and growth and employment in the community, we also have to acknowledge that these jobs, when we look for jobs, we want quality jobs that provide quality care, that provide quality wages to sustain the people. So this is in keeping with the ethos that we've long since established, that we continue to advocate for. I have no problem voting in favor of this resolution for that reason. I get a little squeamish when we get involved in some sense in collective bargaining, but if management in this case can hear that it is the community will that's been expressed time and time again, that a living wage be provided for the work that's being, the just and good work that's being done, then if that in any way moves them, and I hope it does, then perhaps this will have an effect. So that's my greatest hope. Any other questions or comments? This is a resolution, so it only requires a voice vote. So all those in favor, please say aye.
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 Are there any opposed? And are there any abstentions? The resolution passes unanimously. That's in first reading, just to give you that there's an opportunity for a second reading. We vote on this twice just to make sure we got it right the first time, and the next vote will be at the next council meeting in support of this resolution if you're interested. Thank you all. Next up, we have the Northampton Family Fourth petition for fireworks.
I'm Sean Porter, the executive director.
Hi, John. Thank you. You all recall that the Family Fourth, which was actually scheduled for June, got rained out twice. You guys got
a lot of rain.
Yeah, you know, we still had a water ban. Go figure. So and that was the time that had a shelf life, that permit. So this is an opportunity to offer the same permit. So all the same conditions and circumstances are the same. So John, do you have anything you want to add to that?
September 12th and 12th rain date, hopefully not of the 13th, and we hope everybody can come and enjoy it. It's a great event for the community. Great. So
I'll accept a motion.
Make a motion to approve.
We have a motion made and seconded to approve the permit for the Family Fourth, the petition for the fireworks demonstration, which is authorizing the use of fireworks at the park. All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Any abstentions? It's worth sitting here for that, wasn't it?
Oh, yes.
All right. Priscilla, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
No rain.
Thank you.
We have committee meetings minutes. The Committee on Rules, Orders, Appointments, and Ordinance meeting of June 29, 2015 and July 20, 2015. Also, the Committee on Public Safety meeting of June 1st, 2015. The Committee on Social Services, Veterans, Culture, and Recreation meeting March 16, 2015, and June 15, And the Finance Committee meeting for February 19th, March 24th, June 18th, and July 9th, all of 2015. Does anyone so move them
move
as a group?
As a group.
Motion's been made and seconded. Any discussion on these minutes? All those in favor of approval, please say aye.
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 Aye. Any opposed? Any abstentions? Okay.
Okay.
Yes.
What about
the city council meetings?
Right, you missed that.
Yep, we sure did.
Okay.
Yep, thank you. Good catch. So thank you. I was too intent on a break next week. Yes. I'll accept a motion for approval of the city council minutes of June 29th.
So moved.
July 9th and July 20th, 2015.
Second.
Okay, motions are made. Second to move them as a group. Any discussion on these minutes?
No.
All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Next up, we have a reappointment to the Agricultural Commission. This is Robert Bollinger of 78 Mountain Street in Haydenville. The term starts September 2015, expires September 2018. Let's see, Richard Jasky, 774 Bridge Road in Northampton. The term also to start September 2015, expiring September 2018.
Move as a group.
Excuse me?
Just move them as a group.
You want to move those two as a group?
Yes.
Okay. Any discussion on those appointments? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. Next up is a new appointment to the Housing Partnership. This is Todd Weir, 124 Mercer Street in Northampton. The term July 2015 to expire June 2018.
Second.
Motions are made to appoint. And seconded. Any discussion on this appointment? All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Any opposed? Next up, we have a new appointment to the Public Works Commission. This is Wendy Foxman of 105 Fairway Village in Leeds. The term starts July 2015, expires March 2016. This is to fill the unexpired term of Terry Culhane. Accept a motion?
Accept to approve.
Second.
Motion is made and seconded to approve. Any discussion on Wendy? All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Aye. Okay. Any opposition? No. No abstentions? Okay. Next up, we come, this is relative to what we had consolidation of the committees. This is not assure that the second vote will pass, but this is to at least get the process going. Should it pass, this is the appointment of Christine Bissell as the treasurer slash collector, and this to be referred to the committee on ordinance appointments. So,
second.
So, move to refer.
Motions are made and seconded. Any discussion on this referral? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any
aye.
Opposed? So, these are for referral. Also two appointments, Agricultural Commission, John Amasta, 165 Farms Road in Florence, the term to be September 2015 to expire June 2018. This is a reappointment. The Central Business Architecture Committee, Joseph Blumenthal, 39 Chapel Street, Northampton, term of April 2015 to June 2018. This is a reappointment. Human Rights Commission is Jordana Amato, 28 Fox Farms Road in Florence, term to start April 2015, expires June 2018. This is also a reappointment. And this is a new appointment, Lori Wiesel, 46 Grant Ave, Northampton, the term to start August 2015 to June 2017. Then Transportation and Parking Commission, Ann Brooks, 20 Bridge Road, number one in Florence, the term to start August 2015 to expire June 2017. This is Planning Board representative role to fill the fill the expired term of Devin Bruce.
Move as a group.
As a group and seconded by Councilor O'Donnell. All those in favor of referral, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Any abstentions? Now we're going to recess for Finance Committee. Councilor Adams will serve as chair in the absence of Councilor Murphy, and I cede the gavel over to him to go into recess.
Call the meeting to order. Roll call vote, please. Not roll call, please.
Councilor Adams?
Here.
Councilor LaBarge?
Present.
Councilor
Sherrod? Here.
Is there a motion to approve the minutes of the previous meeting?
So moved.
Second. Is there any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Unanimous. We'll move to financial orders 15.478. This is the order for easement at Look Park. Pulaski Park.
Got a bunch of parks.
Upon the recommendation of the mayor, the Department of Public Works ordered that, whereas the city is undertaking the renovation of Pulaski Park, and whereas in conjunction with the renovation of Pulaski Park, Massachusetts Electric Company has agreed to install, construct, reconstruct, repair, replace, add to, maintain, and operate lines for the transmission of high and low voltage electric current and for the transmission of intelligence. And whereas in order for the Massachusetts Electric Company to provide such lines, it requires that the city convey a permanent easement for such purposes. Now therefore be it ordered that the city council authorizes the conveyance to Massachusetts Electric Company for the consideration of $1 of a perpetual right and easement to install, construct, reconstruct, repair, replace, add to, maintain, and operate lines for the transmission of high and low voltage electric current and for the transmission of intelligence in, on, under, and over the premises known as Pulaski Park. Is there a motion?
Make a motion.
Second.
Mr. Mayor?
So the resolution is self-explanatory. The only other thing I would add is that while we would be doing this anyway to make it look better, but actually the park grant that we received actually requires us to bury any power lines. It's sort of a requirement. We actually, you may recall, we had to do this down near Bridge Street School for that park project. There was a line that we had to bury as a condition of the grant. So this is just to give them the easements that are needed for that to run the underground conduit. We're asking for two readings because we're hoping to award a contract and get started on construction possibly before the end of this month. So that's why we'd like to have the easements in place so that Mass Electric can do that work.
Any questions for the mayor? Discussion? Is there a motion to send it forward to the full council with a positive recommendation?
Make a motion to send it to full city council.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Unanimous. This is 15.482, financial order authorizing fire rescue to enter into five-year contract with ambulance billing. Upon the recommendation of the mayor, ordered that, whereas ambulance billing services are a necessity to recover operating expenses for providing emergency medical services, and whereas a five-year contract is necessary for continuity and consistency for ambulance billing and provides the best value to the city, now therefore be it ordered that the Northampton Fire Department is authorized to enter into a five-year contract for provision of ambulance billing services. Motion?
Motion.
Second.
Mr. Mayor?
Yes. This is the authorization we seek here is actually the five-year part. We're allowed to enter into three-year contracts without council authorization, but if we go beyond a three-year contract, we actually have to get you to vote on it. We did a five-year contract last time around because I think we get a better rate by doing a longer period. The request for two readings, there was a bit of a miscalculation regarding the council's summer meeting schedule, but the current contract expires September 1st, and your next meeting is September 3rd. So that's why there's a request for two readings. And again, the money's already been appropriated. The money's in the budget for this contract. There's a Chapter 30B requirement that if you do a contract longer than 3 years, you need to have the permission of the mayor and city council to be able to do that. So that's what we're requesting.
Now, in the final sentence, it says the Northampton Fire Department is authorized, but this is for the entire fire rescue department, right?
Yes. That may just be a Scrivener's error. If it says fire department, it should say fire rescue. If you can correct that or amend it, correct
motion
it.
Motion friendly amendment, change it to fire and rescue.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Are there any questions for the mayor? Further discussion? All those in, motion to send it forward to the full council with a positive recommendation.
Motion to full
second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Unanimous. Financial Order 15.483, financial order to reprogram $3,908.07 from FY cash capital plan to FY16 cash capital plan for purchase of mail courier vehicle. Upon the recommendation of the mayor, whereas City Council appropriated $20,000 for a new vehicle for the Central Services mail courier function as part of the FY16 cash capital program, whereas quotes have been received and the lowest feasible quote for a vehicle that meets the Green Communities mile per gallon efficiency standard is $22,899 for a base model 2016 Subaru Forester, whereas there is $3,908.07 remaining in unallocated FY14 cash capital plan funds, now therefore it be ordered that $3,908.07 be reprogrammed from the balance of the FY14 cash capital plan to supplement the funds appropriated from the FY16 cash capital plan to purchase and equip a vehicle for the Central Services mail courier functions. A motion?
Second.
Mr. Mayor?
Yes. In the original capital plan that you approved, there was $20,000 allotted. The intent had been to look at either a used or a late model, last year's model, Subaru Forester for that department. In looking at quotes, I've got the specific example. We received a quote for a 2013 Forester with 34,000 miles on it for $21,200, or a 2016 Forester for $24,000. So we opted, we believe it's a better expenditure to spend a little bit extra to get the newer car without the mileage on it. And then we did have this excess cash capital funds that will not only allow us to pay for the full price of the vehicle, but also for the equipment that's needed to go with it, the signage and all the other pieces that have to go in it. So that's why we're asking for this transfer. Again, it's funds you already approved in FY14 that we'll just move over into this cash capital program in FY16 to be able to cover it.
Councilor LaBarge?
Mayor, what is the incidental equipment?
When we get a vehicle, we have to, we get it, we take it in and get it lettered. We have to get it lettered that says, building inspector or electrical inspector, that kind of stuff. Yeah. So that's the main thing that we'll be doing. I don't know if he has any other kind of emergency equipment that he puts on the vehicle, like flashers or cones or things like that. If they have to go out to a scene, I'm not sure, but we that's fairly standard.
Are there any other questions for the mayor? Is there any further discussion? Motion to send it forward with a positive recommendation to the full council.
Recommendation to the full city council. Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. It's unanimous.
And on this one, I know the council president had asked me. We're requesting two readings. It's not, I think Central Service is fairly confident the quotes will last until September 3rd, but that's the only reason they had requested two readings, was to try to execute the purchase sooner rather than later. But if the council wants to wait till September 3rd, there's no deadline or anything like that. So you would ask me about that one.
Thank you.
Yep.
Yeah, I'd be a little more comfortable with the less suspension of rules relative to readings, the mm-hmm. better. So, yeah.
15.484, financial order to reprogram $7,329.95 from FY13 capital plan project for removal of underground storage tanks to Academy of Music fire escape repair project.
So this is the fire escape repair project that we've been working on in the aftermath of putting the new fire escapes. Particularly, it's on the new South Street side of the building, where if you drive by there today, you can see that you can see the sonotubes underneath the fire escape, and there's a lot of dirt and gravel. And so we're going to basically go in and clean all of that up. We did get pricing from the contractor after getting the approval of the city council. There were a few more issues that we hadn't anticipated, so we need this additional money to be able to pay what the bid price was for the job. The reason we're asking for two readings is because we would doing this work is going to be is going to require us to close one of the lanes of New South Street to do the work, and we prefer not we prefer to do it before school buses and school is back in session, because it will create a bit of a backup on that section of South Street, and I don't have to tell the council that. So if we can get this work done, they can get started. I believe they're planning to start next week on the project. So that's why we'd like to get two readings to be able to approve the contract instead of waiting till September 3rd.
Any questions for the mayor?
August 26th and 27th is when they want to do the work. So.
Is there any discussion on this? Is there a motion?
Second.
Motion to send it forward?
Yes. Second.
I may not be here later when you bring these up because I have to go to school committee. That's why I'm giving you the rationale for the two readings now. So.
That's fine.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Unanimous. 15.485, financial order, Pulaski Park, Phase 2, Park Grant. Upon the recommendation of the Mayor, David J. Narkowitz, in order to file and accept grants with and from the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, Executive Office of Energy and Environmental Affairs for the Parkland Acquisitions and Renovations for Communities Program for improvements to Pulaski Park, Phase 2, Overlook Expansion. Whereas Pulaski Park is a community-wide asset and the preservation and improvements to this park are a city priority, as evidenced in the Open Space, Recreation, and Multi-Use Trail Plan dating 2011 to 2018, and whereas Pulaski Park is dedicated to park and recreation purposes under Massachusetts General Laws Section 45, Section 3, and whereas the Phase 2 Overlook expansion of Pulaski Park, guided in principle by the Open Space Plan, will greatly enhance this facility with improved infrastructure, outdoor public meeting space, path systems, site lighting, universal access, etc. And whereas the main focus of the plan is to renovate Pulaski Park to enrich the enjoyment by all residents and visitors to the city, the project costs and fiscal constraints prevented the city from proceeding with renovations to the park. And whereas the park renovations were viewed as a project that might be implemented in a series of phases over time or as one project when fiscal resources become available, with the intention of securing grant funding when and if available to assist in this effort. And whereas the Executive Office of Energy and Environmental Affairs is offering reimbursable grants to cities and towns to support the preservation and restoration of urban parks throughout the parklands, the park program. The park is a reimbursement program which requires the city demonstrate that it has all the necessary funds to improve park priorities prior to state reimbursement. And now for it be ordered that the City Council appropriates and authorizes the treasurer, with the approval of the mayor, to borrow $625,000 over 15 years under Massachusetts General Law Chapter 44B, Section 11, and Massachusetts General Law Chapter 44, Section 8C, or any other enabling authority, for the purpose of improvement of public parks and playgrounds on said property, and the mayor be authorized to file on behalf of the City of Northampton any and all applications deemed necessary for grants and or reimbursements from the Commonwealth of Massachusetts deemed necessary under the Park Act and or any others in any way connected with the scope of this article, and the mayor be authorized to enter into all agreements and execute any and all instruments as may be necessary on behalf of the City of Northampton to effect said renovation, and that the mayor be and is hereby authorized to take such other actions as are necessary to carry out the terms, purposes, and conditions of this grant. Mr. Mayor.
So again, as has happened many times when the city has applied for these park grants, one of the requirements or ways of showing the city's commitment to the project is we ask you to do a borrowing authorization for the full cost of the project. You did it for phase one of the Pulaski mm-hmm. Park project, and then we came back and rescinded it when we received the park grant exactly. award. So we are applying for another round of park grants for $400,000, which we hope will be 400 of this $625,000. We've also filed this week a notice of intent with the CPC to make application to them as well for some of the funding. So this is just one of those things that we do as a condition of applying for the park grant. So even though it sounds like you're voting to borrow $625,000, that is not our intent. and we will, in fact, you know, if we don't receive the grant, we'll have to figure out different ways to pay for it.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes, so what this is actually doing, Mayor, is at that $625,000 over the 15 years, it's giving you the full authority to file on behalf of the city and or any and all of the applications that are deemed necessary for grants and reimbursements. That's what this is all about, correct?
That's correct, and we will, and we have filed a grant with UEA for this park program for $400,000. And we're
Thank
hopeful
you.
That we'll receive it. We've received it in past years, so we're hopeful we'll receive it again.
Thank you.
The request for second reading is, and I did check with Mr. Fiden on this, we've submitted the application. They're reviewed on a rolling basis. He just, you know, I think he's would love to have it, everything in place, knowing that it's in place and not waiting another 3 weeks for the second reading. So that's the request. I obviously leave it in the council's hands to decide. There's not a deadline or anything like that. We have submitted the application. This is supporting material that we have to send as soon as we can to be part of the application, and we don't know when they're going to start looking at applications.
Okay.
I think he's wanting it to be there as soon as possible, so it's part of the application. So that was what the request for two readings from Mr. Fiden was about.
Councilor Scheer?
So you said you don't know when they're going to start looking at applications. There's not a time you expect to hear back?
No, although we hope to hear, you know, early next year is when we hope to hear. I mean, they tend to do these a couple times throughout the year, but we hope to hear, you know, certainly before we can move forward with the project.
So in that case, phase two would happen next summer?
Phase two would happen, we hope next spring or summer, yeah. And actually, that's sort of been the plan, that we would, phase one would take place most of this year, and probably some of it would carry over into the spring of next year, and that we could then roll right into phase two, probably in the summer. That's actually, given that this will be FY17 dollars, we probably can't start until July 1st of next year, which is kind of what happened this year with our park grant. So that'll give us time to finish construction, get all the design work done, and hopefully be able to seamlessly move into phase two.
Yeah. Councilor Dwight?
The authority is for $625,000, so there's $250,000 that wouldn't be covered by the park grant. Where is that $250,000?
The 225?
225.
Yeah, that's what we'll be applying to the CPC for.
So the CPC.
And as you may recall, we applied for it. We did apply for it in the fall. And they chose to not to give us that $225,000, but to phase it in and have us come back and apply in this round.
So it's your intent that should any of these grants fail, that you don't plan on proceeding with the borrowing?
No, we would have to reassess that and figure out how we would do that, how we would fund it. We would not fund it just. We would not borrow it from just general revenues. You know, we'd have to come back and have a discussion about what we would do. I'm being optimistic that we'll get the park grant. And we have a good track record with those, so we'll be hopeful that happens. Yeah. But I think when people see phase one of the park, I think there's going to be a lot of folks that will be supportive of trying to do phase two. So.
Any other questions for the mayor? Is there any further discussion? Is there a motion to send it forward with a positive recommendation?
Motion to send to City Council.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Unanimous. Yes. 15.490, financial order to accept donations from the Florence Mercantile totaling $39,348.26 for the Trinity Park Foundation project. Upon the recommendation of the mayor, order that the Northampton City Council gratefully accepts donations from the Florence Mercantile, the business group of the Florence Civic and Business Association, totaling $39,348.26 to the Trinity Park Foundation project, and in accordance with Massachusetts General Law Chapter 44, Section 53A, approves using the gifted funds to construct a fountain at Trinity Park in Florence.
Second.
Yes. Some of you may recall several years ago that one of our former colleagues, Councillor Tacey, began working on a project to try to raise funds to restore the fountain. There's currently a fountain at that park. It has been non-operational for many, many years, doesn't function, and so he began a process of trying to raise funds for that. The project got a little more complicated in terms of the design requirements and the engineering requirements and the expertise required to actually construct the kind of fountain that the DPW would allow, would permit. It is in a city park. The Florence Civic and Business Association teamed up on the project, and through their mercantile association that you referenced, began a fundraising effort. The DPW basically worked with them with the approved design, got quotes from contractors for it, and then basically the Florence Civic and Business went out to raise additional funds in addition to the funds that had been previously raised for the project. So these are the funds that they are basically gifting to us so that the DPW can carry out the construction of the fountain. Mr. Tacey is going to be assisting with the project with the demolition of the current. He is going to be donating his labor to the project for demolishing the current fountain and prepping the site for a contractor to come in to do the actual fountain build. So that's also helping to defray some of the costs. And again, some of the funds that have been raised earlier have been contributed to this donation that you're receiving tonight. So the request for two readings on accepting the gift is that we want to be able to get the site prep work done by the end of August, because I believe mid-September the contractor has got time to begin working on it. So we want to allow that site prep work to get started right away. So that there's enough time to get it done so that then the contractor can move in with the hope of getting the fountain completed by this year.
Who's the contractors?
I don't know if we've awarded. I think it's out to bid. Yeah, I think we got prices and it's out to bid. The DPW is bidding it.
Thank you.
But we did talk to, it's a concrete job, but it's a very unique pour because it has to be a bowl, kind of a pour. It's not something that everybody can do. And so that's why there's specialized folks who do it. And then there's, installation of water lines and running water connections and all those kinds of things. And when it's done, it's going to be very much like the park, like the fountain that's up, in the triangle.
Jinsky Park.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So very similar to that. So. And obviously, I'm grateful to the Florence Civic and Business for going out and raising this from their business community. They're not obviously not using any city funds or applying for CPA funds or any of those things. They wanted to do it through their membership.
Yep. Any questions for the mayor?
Mm-hmm.
Any further discussion?
Send it to both city council.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes. Is there any new business? Is there a motion to adjourn?
Move to adjourn.
Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. We convene back in regular session. And guess what's up? We got financial orders, and we're going to do them in we're going to do a slightly different order, but the same orders. First reading. First up, we have the order to accept the donations from Florence Mercantile. So $39,348.26 for the Trinity Park Fountain Project. I'll accept a motion.
Move to approve.
Second.
Okay. I'm presuming here in each instance a waiving of the reading since Councilor Adams did the courtesy. Okay. All right. It's okay. Any further discussion on this? Did we get a second, right? Okay.
Yes.
Just letting her catch up. She's got. Ready?
Yep.
Here we go. Roll call, please.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor White.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor LeBart.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Sheriff.
Yes.
There was a request, as I recall.
Yep.
Is there a motion?
Second.
All those in favor of suspending rules for second reading?
Aye.
What, there wasn't a request for suspension rules on this one?
Well, no, it says first reading.
Well, this is Trinity Park.
Yes, there,
but
was.
There was.
That's what I thought.
Yes.
It's not listed here, but there was, yes, you there requested was because yes. The September 20th, in yeah. September was when they were hoping to get the project going. So the motion to suspend, Councilor Spector made the motion, Councilor LaBarge seconded to suspend rules. Any discussion, further discussion on the suspension of rules? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, I'll accept a motion.
Second reading.
Second reading's moved. Is there a second? Okay. Discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor White.
Yes.
Councilor Fine.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
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 Okay, there is a request of, here for two readings. This is the financial order authorizing fire rescue to enter a 5-year contract to our ambulance bill. I'll accept a motion.
Move approval.
Second.
Seconded. Okay. Discussion on this? No? Okay. Roll call, please.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor
White. Yes.
Councilor
Kwan.
Yes.
Councilor
LaBarge. Yes.
Councilor
O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shearer.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Suspend Rule
14. Second. Motions made to suspend rules and seconded. Any discussion on the suspension rules to allow for a second reading tonight? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay. Roll call, please. I'm guessing, is there any other discussion? I'm sorry, no? Okay, roll call, please. Oh, I'm sorry.
Move second reading.
Thank you. Motions made and seconded for second reading. There we go. Any further discussion on that? Roll call, please.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor White.
Yes.
Councilor Pine.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shearer.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Passes unanimously in two readings. Next up, we have the financial order to reprogram $3,908.07 from the FY15 cash capital plan to the FY16 cash capital plan for purchase of a mail courier vehicle.
To approve.
Motion's made.
Second.
Seconded. Any further discussion on this? I'm assuming the incidentals don't include racing stripes and things like that.
I did misspeak. The final price is actually $22,899. So
that's when it's all tricked out?
Without the accessories, yeah.
Oh, without the bling.
Exactly.
Okay. So, okay. 22,000. Okay. Does that change anyone's mind?
Nope.
I'm thinking
all of this. Okay. Anyone concerned about the bling? Roll call, please.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shearer.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Suspend Rule 14.
Motions are made to suspend rules and seconded. Any discussion?
Was this one of those that there was no actual urgency here?
What's that?
Is this one of the ones where a second reading isn't necessary?
The only question we did ask about the price quotes, they think the price quotes will hold up,
right.
So there's no urgency if it's not needed. But we would like to just get the procurement done. I mean, it's money you've already appropriated. It was already appropriated in the capital plan. So that's it.
You know, as I've said, I mean, my preference is if it's not absolutely essential, if there's not a deadline that we're running up against and a risk of loss of revenue to the city, I think it's kind of important that we abide by the rules that we have laid out for two readings over a period of time to allow other opinions. So it's, I've expressed my concern, but the motion's on the floor, so I would speak in opposition. Any other discussion on the suspension of rules? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Nay.
Opposed. We have three nays. So I'll accept a motion that passed.
Second reading.
Second reading's been made. And seconded. Any discussion on the second reading?
Roll call, please.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor Labarge.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Sherrill.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes. Okay. Let me catch up here. I got to get out of my sulk. Next up is the financial order to reprogram $7,329 from FY13 capital plan project for the removal of underground storage tanks at the Academy of Music fire escape repair project.
Move to approve.
Motion's been made. Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion on this? Roll call, please.
Councilor Labarge.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Sherrill.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Suspend Rule 14.
The motion passes in first reading. The motion's been made to suspend rule.
Second.
Is there a second?
Second.
Second. Any second. Discussion on the suspension rules? I would say that I'm all in favor of the suspension as per request. All those in favor of suspending rules, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Any abstentions? Man, I keep losing the Wi-Fi here. So I'll accept a motion for a second reading.
Move to approve.
Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shearer.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor
White?
Yes.
Councilor
Klein?
Yes.
Councilor
White? Yes. We have the financial order for Pulaski Park Phase 2. This is the park grant. This is a request for two readings. I'll take the motion.
Move to approve.
Second.
Discussion on this? I just want to say that I've heard, you know, social media scuttlebutt about the park as it exists now. It now looks actually really great. But that's because the trees have been removed, benches have been removed, it's eventually basically been turned into a vacant lot. But the concern is that we're going to pour a pile of concrete in this and turn it into the virtual skate park or something like that. Importantly, I just want to go on record, and plus with phase two, there will be a significant expansion of green space, almost doubling the amount of green space that we have now. All right. So. Any other discussion beyond my blathering? No.
Are we going to be doing two readings on this?
There's a request for that.
Okay.
Yes. So at your pleasure. So any other questions or discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Sherrill.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor White.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor Labarge.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Suspend Rule 14.
Second. There's been a motion seconded for to suspend rules. All those in favor of suspending
aye.
Rules?
Aye.
Same deal. I think there's no actual urgency or reason to suspend rules on this, unless I'm mistaken.
This is one of the ones that wasn't requested.
That's what the mayor said. Well, it's requested, but I think it's just something that was the preference of the planning department director. The mayor, as I recall, the mayor's not here anymore. That's what I heard. If no one else recalls that, then you can play it safe.
No, and I do recall the mayor saying something to the effect that it is the preference for everyone to move further just so they can start to plan, and as they exactly. The sooner they get the order in. But there is not, but he also said that there was not a drop dead deadline that we're running up against that would counter to this.
I think this is the one where he said that Wayne Fiden had requested that just so that we're in the pool and it's rolling along okay. 3 weeks earlier.
If there's a practical reason to get it in the hopper earlier for in terms of, you know, the grant itself, then that would be acceptable, I think so.
Susan, is there a practical reason to get it in the hopper sooner? I mean, do chances increase as you're...
I think since we don't know when they're going to start the review process, it would be in our best interest to have that paperwork in.
Okay. Any further discussion on the suspension of rules? All those in favor, please say aye.
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 And I'll stand as opposed. So, but rules are suspended.
Move second reading.
Second reading moved and seconded. Any discussion on this? Roll call, please.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor White.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor Labarge.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Sherrill.
Yes.
Thank you.
This is, now we're on a second reading. This is the financial order to purchase 17 acres for the Rocky Hill Greenway off East Hampton Road. Waive reading? Is that your pleasure?
Yes.
Yes.
I'll accept a motion.
Move approval.
Second.
Thank you. Any discussion? No? Roll call, please.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor
Levar. Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Sherr.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
That passes in second reading unanimously. We have the financial order for the purchase, and this is also a second reading, the purchase of 3.3 acres for the historic Mill River Greenway off Manhattan Road.
Move to approve.
Motion's made.
Second.
And seconded. Discussion? Roll call.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor Levar.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Sherr.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
That passes in second reading unanimously. I'm going to give you a chance to catch up. are you there? Okay. This is a second reading to this financial order to purchase an agricultural preservation restriction on 0.85 acres off Island Road.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion's made and second. Remember this discussion from before. Any questions? Hope not, because there's no one here to answer them. Roll call, please.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor
Levar. Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Yes.
Councilor Spector?
Yes.
Councilor Adams?
Yes.
Councilor
Carney? Yes.
That passes in second reading unanimously. We have the financial order to acquire land owned by Peter B. Bay on Hunts Road. This is second reading.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Discussion? Roll call, please.
Yes.
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 Yes. That passes in second reading unanimously. This is a financial order to accept an affordable housing restriction at Christopher Heights, also a second reading.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Further discussion on this? Okay. Roll call, please.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Sherr.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor
Klein.
Yes. Passes unanimously in second reading. I just want to say for folks watching at home, it seems that we're going through this perfunctory process and that we are passing all these things without debate. There was actually vigorous discussion and explanation about all these items at our last meeting in July. And so if you have any questions about that, please refer to that video and watch that scintillating meeting to get a sense of what we're talking about. We have a financial order to surplus a parcel on Hockenham Road and transfer to the USA, that's the country in which we live in, for inclusion in the Conti Fish and Wildlife Refuge. And this is second reading. I'll accept the motion.
Move approval.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Any further discussion on this one? Roll call, please.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
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 Passes unanimously in second reading. Now we move on to orders and ordinances. This is there's a request for two readings on this one. You'll recall. I'm sorry. Oh yeah, we already voted this. I'm sorry. Whew, that's right. And this is relative to Pulaski Park as well, but this is an order for easement at Pulaski Park, and there's a request for two readings on this one. Hang on a second. Damn. Do you have a copy of it? I had it popped up, but then I lost the internet. Councilor Adams did address this easement issue. This is for all the electricals and the services that go underneath. Do you want me to
wait reading?
Right, I'll spare you that. So I'll accept a motion to put this on the floor.
Make a motion to put
second.
It.
Second.
Any further discussion about what this involves and the reason for it? Okay. Roll call, please.
Councilor Sherr.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Counselor Adams?
Yes.
Counselor Carney?
Yes.
Counselor White?
Yes.
Counselor
Yes.
Okay.
Suspend rules.
Doing two readings on
this? Thank you. There has been a motion to suspend rules.
Second.
Second. Okay. Any discussion on the suspension rules on this one? All those in favor of suspending rules, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Accept a motion. Second reading?
Second reading.
Is there a second?
Second.
Second. Thank you. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Counselor Spector?
Yes.
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 That passes in second reading, and that's unanimously. No, was that first reading?
Second
reading.
That was second.
All right. Second.
Jesus. All right. I'm going to get the next one. This is a first reading for this one, and if the internet works, I'll be even to call it up. This is the an ordinance pertaining to limited time parking on North Maple Street in Florence. And come on, here we go. All right, this is upon the recommendation of Councilor Ryan O'Donnell and the Transportation Parking Commission. It's an ordinance of the City of Northampton, and be it ordained by the City Council of the City of Northampton, the City Council assembled as follows. Parking shall be prohibited in the following locations after the expiration of the indicated time limit during the indicated hours and days. On North Maple Street easterly, 1 hour, 9 a.m. to 6 p.m., all except Sundays and public holidays, and extended to 9 p.m. on Fridays. And that's from Depot Street Avenue. That's really okay.
Where is
it? Okay, he says now it's Depot Avenue. Okay. It's I like that font. I think to the southerly side of the Northampton Bikeway. Also on North Maple Street easterly, 15 minutes. And then striking all no parking up parallel 9 a.m. and then adding 9 a.m. to 6 p.m., all except Sundays and public holidays, and extended to 9 p.m. on Fridays. And this is the south side of Depot Avenue, and to a point 30 feet southerly. The motion's been made. Is there a motion?
I move approval.
Okay. And it's second. A second? Okay. Councilor O'Donnell.
Getting a little punchy there with the pronunciation.
Well, I don't know. It's written on mine in rhetoric. It
indicates that you have to use a French accent.
Exactly.
It's done in like graffiti font.
I tried to find creepy font for Halloween, but
it's a font.
Well, this has to do. The different fonts indicate the funny font is when the Transportation Parking Commission amended the ordinance, which itself amends the existing code, and the font was transformed. Surprising way. But basically, the best way to describe this is let's dumb it down even further and just look at the picture. This is what the sign looks like that's currently there. The sign says it's 15-minute parking, according to what the council president said, and this just makes the code conform to reality. It's a technical ordinance. That's all it is.
Yeah, there's the picture. Hildes. And Patty Hildes. So, let it be known that Councilor O'Donnell has gone and reviewed every sign in the city. He's determining. We have a plethora of signs. I think clarification is necessary, and this goes a long way towards that.
Wherever there's an Andre the Giant sticker, I also modify the code to reflect.
Or stop bush.
Exactly.
Stop sign is to. Okay. So, any further discussion on this? Any other questions of Councilor O'Donnell and his good work? Roll call for first reading, please.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor White.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarre.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
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 That passes unanimously in first reading, and look forward to seeing it again next week. Next up, we have this is an ordinance to revise. Oh wow, that popped right up. Okay, this is to revise section 312-99, violations and penalties. This is second reading. This comes with a positive recommendation from Committee on Rules, Orders, Appointments, and Ordinances.
You want approval?
Reading on this?
Yes, please.
Okay. So there's a motion. Councilor O'Donnell, you're making the motion. Put it on the floor.
Yes.
And a second from Councilor Adams. Any further discussion on this? Roll call, please.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
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 Passes unanimously in second reading. Next up, we have a in second reading, the ordinance to revise section 312-99, violations and penalties, second reading. Wait a minute.
Move to approve it.
Yeah. Is there a motion?
I did.
Yep. Moved and seconded. Any further discussion? Roll call.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor
Sherrill?
Yes.
Councilor
Yes.
Councilor Adams?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Passes unanimously in second reading. Next up, ordinance. This is for second reading on this with the positive recommendation from the Committee on Rules, Orders, Appointments, and Ordinances. This is an ordinance to establish a special committee to review city ordinances. Accept a motion.
Move to approve.
Discussion. One of the things the city solicitor has made some recommendations. As we said, Councilor O'Donnell caught this. The fact that it's mandated by charter every year, starting with a five or a zero, that we have to, the council is charged with reviewing all its ordinances. The fact is that we just did it.
Yeah,
it was part of the charter development process and along with the mayor's administrative order, so it would be enormously redundant. So what we're going to do is review procedures, redundancies, and things like that, just do some prophylactic work that will allow us in 5 years to really sink our teeth into it, or whoever's left standing, sink their teeth into reviewing all the ordinances in a proper time span. But this is, so that's what this committee will do, and I'll be appointing that soon. And Councilor Adams, do you have a question?
You just answered one, but the charter says every year ends in five or zero. It's every 5 years.
I think five and a zero, yeah. And since we're 2015, and we just started on the charter in 2014, it's really, so. Yeah, and I'll be appointing that soon. So. So I'll any further discussion on this? Okay, roll call, please.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
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 Yes. We have an ordinance pertaining to 24-hour parking. This is to refer to the Committee on Rules, Orders, Appointments.
Take it as a group.
I'd like to move to refer G, H, and I as a group.
Okay. The motion's made to refer the last three items, and the first one I read. The second one will be pertaining to parking on Prospect Street, and then also the other will be pertaining to parking at Northampton Senior Center.
Second.
All to be referred to ordinance. Motions are made and seconded. Second. As a group.
Second.
Any
it.
Discussion on that?
No, I second it.
Okay. All those in favor of referral, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Okay, that passes unanimously. Is there any update from me? No. Is there any committee chairs? No information request. I'd like to point out that we just went through a six-page agenda PDQ. Congratulations to you all. I hope you enjoy the rest of your summer. I'll accept a motion to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Thank you again.